pray about stuff and hear from God. Otherwise, you can be what? Swayed and influenced by every wind and every doctrine, and you can end up losing out on the little bit you have. They've been trying to what? Water it down even more so that you can what? Look good in the eyes of the unchurch. Amen. Change Sunday evening. Amen. See, this is something that all of us are being influenced. Changing Sunday evening services and Wednesday evening prayer meetings, or eliminating them. Now this is the movement. Now this movement is going to flow right into what? The false church, the apostate church, that's going to be left when Jesus comes. See, when Jesus comes, amen, the apostate church will be what? Left behind. And they're going to help form that great movement that will be hooked up with the what? The Antichrist. And so it's all leading there. It's going to be a watered-down church. You can do anything, no standards. You can live any kind of way. You can. You don't have to conform to nothing. You don't have to half go to church. Show up whenever you feel like it. No restrictions, no standards, no nothing, and no conditions. Okay, so, I can tell a vast difference since we cut back. You know, the pressure on pastor, let's cut back. Let's get back to the church. They do everything in an hour. Then the pressure comes on me. And so how can we cut back prayer? Cut back everything. Cut back, amen, cut back the anointing. Cut back everything. That's constantly, because, you know, there are people can go to churches and they maybe do everything in 1 hour. And then come to Northside, we're here from 9 o'clock. So I'm trying to get you out for prayer at 9 o'clock. And being here from 9 o'clock to what, 12:30 or 1 o'clock, man, that's a long time. And people are rebelling against being in church too long. Sunday school, you know, this was no problem years ago, was it, Brother Bill? Wasn't no problem, but it's a problem now. People say, I ain't gonna come at 9 o'clock. We don't be done until 12:30. I ain't gonna come in at 9 o'clock. See, where the spirit of self-denial is gone. People don't want to pay no price. They don't want to what? Go beyond anything that's what? Not comfortable, that's not easy. And when you boil all of it down, if you're going to streamline, if you're going to make everything instant, someone said that if you get a 15 sermonette, you're going to end up with a whole bunch of Christianettes. A lot of Christianettes, So, I mean, years ago, you could find people that would pray all night. Pray for hours and they enjoy it. And God would reveal things, show them things, and miracles, signs and wonders and things were happening. But today, because of the modern approach and because of what we see, and you say, well, they got 20,000 members. We didn't have to come in 9 o'clock and stay all that time. Look how big they're growing. And look how small we are, and we're doing all of this. People rationalize like that. All right, so when you start cutting back, I was here years ago when we prayed more consistent. We were here night after night in certain times in prayer every night. And this was the time that we saw our greatest results. It was a different quality of believer. Denials, now they came back on Sunday night then. They came on Monday night. I mean, a great majority of them. Wednesday night. And say Friday night, all night, you would have 50 people here. 75 sometime. But that type of commitment is kind of what? It's outdated. And they label everybody that have these convictions, that really believe in seeking God, living right. And you just think about how many churches really focus on living right, living holy lives. Come against homosexuality. Come against perversion. Do you hear anybody coming out against that? Amen. If you do, amen, it's going to be a little church. All right. Praise God. So, Brother Mariko, you have to make up your mind whether You want to attract the masses and water it down, or preach the truth and let whatever happens happen. Amen. All right, so let me just move on. Sunday school teachers should be removed to different classes or replaced by new teachers more sympathetic with new changes that's been implemented. All right, crosses and other traditional Christian symbol may be moved from your church, inside and outside of the church building. The pulpit may also be removed. Now, this is what the head of these movements are telling all, and pastors are adhering to them by the thousands. Thousands of pastors are following this type of direction. All right, new versions of the Bible are to be used. Only King James, that's out. Are new versions only, and that's to be flashed on the screen during regular service. So that means that you can preach anything you want, and you won't have to be dealing with the old-fashioned scriptures. All right, number 9, the word church can be removed altogether. It can be called a campus. All denominational names must come down and be removed. All right, number 10, eliminate altar calls or salvation invitation at the end of services. And the last, number 11, eliminate such words as, during your preaching, don't use words unsaved, lost, sin, hell, heaven, and other gospel verities from your pastoral message. And so this is kind of what's kind of going on, and it's, I have one more. Change the term saved and lost to the term church and unchurched. In other words, don't use the word saved and lost anymore. Use church and the unchurched. Those are the way you refer to the saved and lost. Ostracize all who are not avid promoters of this movement. Those that don't believe like you, just ostracize them. Use hostility toward members who do not embrace a new program or who have left your church for another church. Use hostility. So that was the motivation that I have behind the minister, the message the Lord shared, began to deal with me, stay in focus, and I got 6 keys, and the first key I have is discipline. This is a real need today among believers. If you don't find a way to keep yourself disciplined, you're going to actually get off track, discipline. All right, now, there's a scripture in 1 Chronicles, I think all of us know about this. If you have it, 1 Chronicles 12:32, and it says, and of the children of Issachar, which were men that had understanding of the times to know what Israel ought to do. So, you know, the thing that will enable you to understand the times that we're living in and what you need to do, you're going to have spiritual revelation. You're going to have to pray that the eyes of your understanding will be enlightened. And also at the same time, you're going to have to exercise some discipline. Now, this was the key to Daniel's success in the book of Daniel. I was really blessed this past week after sharing a whole lot on the end time. I went back and I just said, I'm just going to read the whole thing again. And when I began to read it, I began to see exactly the key to Daniel's success and why he was so successful. He was actually involved in about 6 different administrations. And he always ended up at the top president, the first in the kingdom. He always got promoted. And I was really... And then on top of all of that, when Nebuchadnezzar had the dream of the tree in the midst of the earth, none of the astrologers, none of the magicians could interpret the dream for him, and they always had to resort to who? Daniel, to what? Interpret the dreams. He was the only one in the kingdom. And I'm going to show you how discipline played a major role in his ability to interpret these dreams. Now, the Bible says he had understanding in all visions and dreams. That's Daniel 1:8. You know, all of the visions, the vision of the great image. How many remember the great image? The head of gold, the breast and arms were of silver, the belly and thighs were of brass, the legs of iron, and the feet were part-eyed and clay. Now, he was the one that was called upon not only to interpret that dream for Nebuchadnezzar, but Nebuchadnezzar had even what? Forgot what he had dreamed. He couldn't even explain or recall the dream. And Daniel, if Daniel hadn't been able to recall the dream and to give him the interpretation of the dream, that meant all of the wise men in the whole kingdom, all of them were going to be what? Destroyed. But Daniel was able to do some things that enabled him to get enlightenment, and God revealed to him the secret. Amen. Now all of these things that we read about in the book of Daniel, you know, we read about the all these visions he had, the visions of the four beasts. It was all the four beasts that Daniel dreamed about, the lion, the bear, the leopard, and the beast with iron teeth. Now, this sounds really difficult to understand, but just a little revelation, a little understanding, is that Daniel had the same vision that what Nebuchadnezzar had of the what? Gold, of the big image. Rather than the head of gold, the breast of silver, and the belly of brass, Daniel saw it this way. He saw these kingdoms as what? Lions, bear, leopard, beast. That was just so, that's so easy to know when you're reading Daniel. It's so easy because when you hear Daniel talking about the lion, the bear, the leopard, and the beast with an iron teeth, it's the same thing that Nebuchadnezzar had what? Dreamed, and Daniel was able to what? Interpret that dream for him. So Daniel was, he was a very gifted person, and we want to know what was behind all of these gifts and all of these talents and all of these spiritual abilities that he had. Because if we could find out how Daniel derived all of this, then I believe that God has no respect of a person. I believe that we could get a whole lot more revelation. Now, we are here struggling, trying to understand the little book on Revelation that we read. See, it just